a tremor that may presage a major, major earthquake that would come down from Orange County all the way into the heart of Hollywood, a major one. And also Yellowstone is acting up. It's going to be an interesting program. But we start with our familiar, oh, I get so sick of this. The Obamacare deadline is finally here, but not really, because the White House says millions of Americans have signed up for health care, at least in theory, but we're not sure.
Nobody does know how many enrollees will actually follow through and how it will affect what you pay for health care. Ephraim Graham has more.
With a somewhat flexible deadline, the White House predicts it will reach its original goal of 7 million Americans enrolling for health insurance under Obamacare by the end of the day.
2 months ago, if you'd asked me, I'd have said there's no chance because the rollout was so bungled.
That bungled rollout and now the last-minute push for younger people to sign up are routine fodder for late-night comedians.
All right, so what we're going to do is you're going to hold this healthcare.gov sign, and we'll give you Pharrell's hat, all right, and an e-cigarette to vape on, all right? BuzzFeed is going to eat this up.
Younger people, not surprisingly, are the last people to sign up. I suspect that's who's signing up today and tomorrow.
Prior enrollment reports have shown the vast majority are 35 and older, with more women than men. And that could lead to higher premiums next year, making the program an even harder sell for young people.
It's also not known how many of those who've gotten coverage were previously uninsured. On top of that, the public remains deeply divided, with more opponents of the law than supporters.
And there are still many more questions for those who lost their insurance under the Affordable Care Act because it was deemed substandard.
I think they're cooking the books on this. People want to know the answers to that. They also want to know is once all this is said and done, what kind of insurance will those people actually have? Will they be able to keep the doctor that they want? How much more is it going to cost them?
Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
We didn't mention the story that 20 to 25% of those who have signed up haven't paid anything, and so they might default on the entire process. Terry, this is a nightmare. It's a bureaucratic nightmare that's being imposed on us by a group of ideologues.
Well, you know, the other element that was just referred to, this is even if people have signed up, even if they have paid, there's no definition yet of what the long-term aspect of this looks like. I mean, it's still undefined.
There was a story the other day about a man who thought he had signed up, had actually paid, and then he got into the medical procedures that he had, and the doctor said, "Oops, I'm sorry, your health care doesn't work on this, and you owe us, you know, several hundred thousand dollars." I mean, it was a pretty serious matter. Well, we have a stunning new example of government incompetence when it comes to Obamacare, and John Jessup has more on that story from CBN News Bureau in Washington.
Pat, Maryland has decided to abandon its expensive state-run healthcare website created to comply with Obamacare. The state's health exchange site cost taxpayers more than $125 million, but the Washington Post reports the site is broken beyond repair. Maryland officials reportedly are going to use technology used in Connecticut's healthcare website instead. Other states like Oregon, Minnesota, and Hawaii have experienced major problems with their health exchanges, too. The earthquakes that struck California and Yellowstone Park this weekend are sparking fears that the big one could be coming to the West Coast. Hundreds of aftershocks have rocked the Golden State since Friday when the 5.1 quake hit Los Angeles.
We have a lot of cosmetic damage to structures, and we're trying to cipher through what's cosmetic and what's structural for a hazard. We first go out and assess if there's a collapse, a potential collapse, and now we're really going out and trying to do the secondary investigations.
Friday night's quake centered in La Habra along the Puente Hills Thrust Fault. It stretches from Orange County to Hollywood. Experts say a major quake of magnitude 7.5 or larger along that fault could kill thousands. Meanwhile, the 4.8 quake that shook Yellowstone is the strongest since 1980. A bigger quake could have the potential to erupt the park's supervolcano, a force 2,000 times the size of Mount St. Helens. Pat, for years, experts were worried about the San Andreas fault. Now they're saying this is the big one.
Exactly. That Puente fault line apparently is much more serious. The one that we've been looking at for so many years runs on the side, but this one cuts right across from Orange County right into Hollywood. And you can see where it's the Fuente Hills. It comes right into Hollywood, right across there. San Andreas misses that. It's serious, but it's not the same kind of a fall line. But the thing, you know, I worked some years ago in Yellowstone, and we'd go out and see the geysers. We'd swim in the geysers.
Really?
Yellowstone Lake was had geysers coming up out of it. But that is the biggest active volcano, as I understand it, in the world. And if that thing decides it wants to blow, it will envelop the entire United States in ash. It can be a killer from all of our crops. I mean, it is a monstrous thing hanging over us. This was on the northern edge of Yellowstone. It was just an earthquake. It wasn't the volcano going off. But if the seismic activity is starting to stir throughout the West Coast, this is not a good thing. And ladies and gentlemen, one more time, we need to trust the Lord, because we're always on a situation where something in this moving globe we live on can break down. John?
Pat, the Washington community devastated by that deadly mudslide held its first church service since the disaster struck 2 weeks ago. Oso Community Chapel is the only church in town, and its members have been working nonstop helping with relief efforts. On Sunday, they came together to worship God and to share their stories of pain, loss, and God's grace. Staff from CBN's Operation Blessing are working with the church to help those affected by the tragedy. The ministry made a cash grant to the church to help families in need, and it's giving spiritual support to victims and community leaders. Operation Blessing has also set up a communication post to help residents connect with family and friends on the internet. Pastor Gary Ray says the church hopes to be a beacon of healing to the community.
We have a heart to be a blessing now to area residents. There's no way that we would be able to do that effectively were it not for the supporting, were it not for the support of great partners like Operation Blessing. They have come in and came quickly, provided love and prayer, financial support, material support, have held our hands up and helped us move forward in a more organized and effective way. I appreciate the ministry very much.
Meanwhile, the official death toll has risen to 18. Authorities say they've recovered more than two dozen bodies, but won't add them to the official tally until a formal identification is made. 30 people are still unaccounted for. Well, a devastating drought and the harsh winter is costing Americans more at the dinner table. From meat to fruit and vegetables, the cost of food is on the rise. Caitlin Burke reports.
Grocery stores across the country are hiking up the prices of some major food staples. In February alone, prices rose 0.4%. And by the end of 2014, experts say they expect them to increase as much as 3.5%.
A severe drought in the Midwest is one of the factors to blame for the price increase. And the beef industry has been hit especially hard.
Meat supplies are down. We're expecting meat supplies to be down 6 to 7% this year. And when supply goes down, prices tend to go up.
In January, the USDA recorded the highest price for a pound of fresh beef ever recorded since the government agency began tracking the statistic in 1987. And then there's produce. Higher prices this time of year are normal because of the transition from winter to spring. The concern is about prices later in the year.
As the new crops come in, the prices are high, but this year we expect them to go higher, because of some of the crops have been eliminated, mainly because they just won't have enough water.
An unusually cold winter and an increase in demand are other factors that have contributed to the rising price of food.
There might be products that are really affected and other ones that are not. So I think you have to sort of wait and see. And then I think people also will adjust what they eat a little bit to what products are available.
Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
Turning overseas, diplomatic talks between the U.S. and Russia did not bring resolution to the crisis in Ukraine. Secretary of State John Kerry met with his Russian counterpart Sunday in Paris. He called for Moscow to begin pulling back the tens of thousands of troops along the Ukrainian border. Russia claims they're only carrying out military exercises, but the U.S. sees it as an attempt to intimidate Ukraine. Meanwhile, Russia is demanding that Ukraine break up its country into a loose federation of states. The U.S. is ruling out that option unless Ukrainians are at the table. Pat?
You know, John, I have been looking at this situation and saying, what can you do? Well, it's dirty pool, but great nations have used it in the past. We can totally destabilize the Russian economy. I mean, totally. All you got to do is get a room full of high school students who, with computers, that they can begin to play havoc with the bank accounts of the Russian oligarchs, with the bank management, with the fiscal controls of the Russian government. I mean, we can really throw them into chaos. If we could do that Stuxnet virus to the Iranian nuclear facilities, we can certainly do the same thing to the Russians. Maybe that's why Putin is trying to make nice, but the thing is, if he wants Finland, and he wants Latvia and Lithuania and South Ossetia, and he wants all these other countries surrounding him, and if he wants to dominate the Ukraine, he's not going to be able to do it. And he's got to realize that there's a tremendous price, but we don't have to have troops over there. We don't have to have cannons. We don't have to have warplanes. All we have to do is have some people manning computers that begin to do a job on their computer network, and they're out of business. And it's so simple. I don't know why we're not thinking about it. Maybe we don't want to talk about it, and maybe I shouldn't talk about it on this program, but nevertheless, that's where we can get them over a barrel, and it may be that's why Putin decides he'd better do some talking. John?
Pat, North and South Korea exchanged fire over a disputed western sea border today, causing residents of South Korean islands to evacuate to shelters for hours. A South Korean official says the North fired 500 rounds of artillery shells over more than 3 hours. The South responded by firing 300 shells into North Korean waters. No shells from either side were fired at any land or military installations. North Korea also threatened to conduct a fourth nuclear test. Meanwhile, the U.S. and South Korea are holding joint annual military exercises. 7,500 U.S. Marines and 2,000 U.S. sailors are participating. The exercises are reported to be the biggest by the U.S. and South Korea since 1993. They're scheduled to run until April 7th. Well, an American hero of the Vietnam War era passed this weekend. Naval aviator Jeremiah Denton alerted the world to the brutality of the North Vietnamese prison camps. He endured much torture during 8 years in captivity. His story was later depicted in the made-for-TV movie When Hell Was in Session. A practicing Catholic, Denton relied heavily on his Christian faith to survive and help other prisoners. He's best known for telling the world of the terrible treatment in those camps by blinking the word torture in Morse code in a propaganda film broadcast to the world by the North Vietnamese. After the war, he became a U.S. senator from Alabama.
Our first guest on the 700 Club today is one of the heroes of our time. Jeremiah Denton was a Navy commander when he was shot down over North Vietnam in July of 1965. For the next 7.5 years, he was a prisoner of war. After his release in 1973, he was awarded nearly every medal an American can get.
He was also a supporter of and a frequent guest on the 700 Club. Jeremiah Denton was 89 years old. And Pat, I know many here join you in saluting the man Time Magazine called the Admiral from Alabama.
Amazing man. He worked for us for a little while as an ambassador doing some various things. And Jerry Denton was a fabulous guy. He had a wonderful sense of humor. But what those North Koreans did to him, the torture was unbelievable. I mean, the things that he endured and came through. And he was an inspiration to all of our POWs. A great man. And my heart goes out to this nation for the loss of one of his great heroes. But at 89, as I say, I was privileged. When he was in charge of the Joint Forces Command over there at Little Creek, and I forget, you know, they've got so many commands, but
yes.
This was one, the North Atlantic Alliance, and I had lunch with him and asked if he could come and join with a few things that I was doing, and he agreed to do so for a short period of time, and it was a great association, a wonderful man, mm-hmm. and well, we miss him, but America has brought through some of the great heroes. These people have courage beyond anything you could conceive of.
The movie Noah earned the number one spot at the box office during opening weekend, earning an estimated $44 million in the U.S. and $33.6 million abroad. Noah is the latest faith-centric film to succeed at the box office. Others include God's Not Dead, which placed fifth in its second weekend, and Son of God, whose domestic total is at nearly $58 million since opening last month. A new Left Behind film and Exodus will be released later this year, and Heaven Is For Real will be in theaters next month, April 16th. CBN is helping provide clean drinking water around the world. According to the World Health Organization, 768 million people don't have access to clean drinking water, but CBN and its partners are working to change that. So far in 2014, CBN has built 193 wells providing clean drinking water to 75,000 people in countries like Cambodia, India, Peru, and the Philippines. CBN currently has clean water initiatives in 12 countries implemented with local staff and in-country partners. You can find out more about what CBN is doing around the world by logging on to cbn.com/international.